joining us on YouTube, please leave us a comment. Let us know you're here. If you are on the Facebook, please let us know where you're tuning in from, what grow zone you're in, what you're excited to be learning about with us today during tonight's very exciting and awesome live stream. This is our first sort of Cross Canada live stream, and we're so excited to get started. My name is, of course, Emma Terrell. I am the Urban Botanist, and tonight I am joined with Ashley Lebrecque, who is a soil scientist, agronomist, and is based in Saskatchewan. We are going to be talking all things gardening during our session tonight. So please leave us a comment. Let us know where you are tuning in from. I'm going to check us out on Facebook here. We're so excited to get started. Ashley, thank you for joining us today.
No problem. Excited to be here.
We are so excited. Ashley, tell us a little bit about what an agronomist is. What is it that you do? What is it mean? I was like, I need to make sure I'm saying that right. I've got a B.Sc in Agriculture and Bioresources and is a professional agronomist. Please tell us a little bit more about what that means.
Yeah, for sure. So essentially, I majored in soil science and I minored in plant science, but not all agronomists or plant people go that direction. Some people stick with the plant science side and less on the soil science. It's kind of a conglomeration of all sorts. And people who work in this field can work in the environmental sector. So they can work in the reclamation, remediation, and then they can also work in food production, whether that be on a greenhouse level or on a large scale. People go that direction. Some people stick with the plant sector. So
amazing. Sorry, can you hear me still?
Yeah.
I was getting feedback from the live on Facebook. That's fabulous. What I think is so incredible and how you are bringing so much to the table today is you seem to have really dived in to all the different levels when it comes to gardening. So for anyone who's tuning in on Facebook, on YouTube, or watching at a later date, Ashley has an incredible YouTube channel. She is just an endless well of knowledge when it comes to soil. And not a lot of people realize this. People think that plants just need sunlight. They just need water. When in fact, soil is the absolute backbone to the health of our plants, both edible and non-edible plants. So today we're going to be talking about ways to protect your cold climate crops from the heat. Is that right? And then also we're going to be talking about ways to reduce garden water usage. So how to be a lot more efficient and effective at watering our gardens. So let's get into it.
Yes, absolutely.
Super. Okay, so let's talk about what it means to have a cold climate crop. Like, what exactly is the definition of a cold climate crop?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. And I think a lot of people maybe get hung up on that a little bit. But essentially, a cold climate crop refers to anything that generally needs cool nights and cool days to survive. And currently, Western Canada, we already know, is going through a pretty heavy duty heat wave. And so it doesn't get below that 20 degrees Celsius mark. So a cold climate crop on the surface would be something that looks like it's wilting during the day and isn't doing very well. And this is typically brassicas. And in some cases, legumes won't do very well in cold climates. But then obviously, warm climate ones are the ones that we're starting in the house in February, March, that sort of thing, tomatoes, peppers, things of that sort. And then cold climate crops generally are things that we're starting in the garden after our last frost date. And of course, that's going to vary depending on what zone we're in. So in some cases in California, that would be what we plant in the winter. But in Canada, for the most part, it would be our last frost date. So zone, and then we just kind of go back from there. So that's what a cold climate crop would be. So cabbage, Brussels sprouts, all the things of that nature.
Okay, amazing. We have a few people that are tuning in from Saskatchewan. It looks like we've got Rita joining us from Regina. We've got Michael, who's also tuning in from Herbert. Welcome, welcome. And what I think is important to talk about is how different your different grow zone will affect your actual growing season and how it will affect different methods that you can use for protecting your cold climate crop, so to speak. So I'm in grow zone 5A, 5B here in Ottawa, Ontario. And you're in zone 3, is that right?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Everyone is just jealous of you right now.
You hear that, Ottawa folks, Ontario folks? We got it pretty good here.
We do.
We've got a nice little growing season here. And I think, but you know what, that being said, I think you can do what you can with where you're at. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that. So what are some of your tips, some of your best recommendations for someone who's getting started, for someone who is really also wanting to pump up their crop game and really wanting to ensure that those cold climate crops are going to be successful and going to flourish? What are some of your biggest tips, your biggest hacks?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think in a lot of cases for people planting cold climate crops, it actually begins before the frost date begins. So typically when we think of planting our gardens, we are checking that calendar to see when our frost-free days are beginning. And that typically isn't always the best result. We actually want to walk it back to maybe sometimes even 3 weeks, depending on the year. And generally you can tell from your springtime temperatures what exactly that's going to look like. So this spring, right away, you could tell off the hop, it was getting hot fast. We were running out of water in the soil quickly. So we could actually bump that back 3 weeks before our last frost-free date. And the reason for this is because when those plants germinate, and if they germinate before the frost-free dates begin, those cotyledons and those leaves that are closer to the ground actually won't suffer any frost. And the reason they won't suffer any frost is because they have the buffer of the soil and the heat of the soil to act as an insulator. So we don't end up with burnt or damaged leaves if we end up with frost before the frost-free date. This also gives us a little bit of a leg up to, you know, run out of time of, you know, the heat that we're experiencing right now. So in an ideal world, if we planted our lettuce and our herbs early, we wouldn't have bolting because we would have harvested or be getting ready to harvest everything before we ended up with a massive heat wave. Now, our heat wave came a little bit early this year, so it's a little bit of a different scenario. Yeah, usually it's August. This year we decided to jump the gun here in Canada.
Yeah. And I think what I found was so interesting is that you have some fabulous ideas for how to actually manage heat in the garden, which is not something that I think a lot of people think about, especially in Canada, is we're like, oh no, like bring on all the heat, give us all the heat. But it can have a very negative effect on our crops. Can you speak to what those effects might be if we're not managing heat in our garden, so to speak?
Yeah, so I think typically we have two effects. We have both heat effects and then we have sun issues. And so we will see both in the midst of a heat wave. Now, the sun issue may be dampened in the case of clouds or in some cases smoke. So right now in Saskatchewan, Alberta, BC, while it's still very warm outside, we're not going to experience the same burning we experienced 2 weeks ago because we have, unfortunately, the cover of smoke from those forest fires out in BC, which actually are a huge factor in how we would actually manage our garden itself. So if we're talking from a heat perspective, if we're wilting and things are looking a little bit droopy, we first need to analyze, is it a cold climate crop or is it a warm climate crop? If it's a cold climate crop and we're experiencing that wilt, that's normal. We shouldn't get too excited about it. We want to water in the morning. We want to water in the evening. And because we have high heat and high sun, we can actually water the leaves and we don't have to worry about things like bacterial buildup or fungal buildup because we have the heat removing that water through evaporation. So that's one thing we want to look at. If we're noticing wilting in our cabbage, our Brussels sprouts, it's okay. We don't have to panic. It's completely normal. There's no real fix to that other than shade cloth. So don't freak out. But if we're noticing it in our tomatoes, our peppers, things of that nature, more of the hardy Southern American type crops, that is something where we actually have to analyze how we're watering. And so while people will say, you know, make sure you water daily, sometimes it actually may mean turning the sprinklers on or watering deep into the actual soil profile. So typically speaking, if we water once every 3 days for half an hour, 45 minutes at a time, we are going to drive those roots down. And then if we the times, the days where we're not watering, what's going to happen is our roots are going to keep on digging for that water. If we water every single day for those tomatoes, peppers, what ends up happening is we end up with a root system that's very superficial on the soil surface because it has no reason to dive down. That means if we go on holidays or we forget to water one day, we're not feeling good, then our roots don't have the biomass going before we end up with a drought scenario. So watering twice a day for some crops actually is counterintuitive, whereas watering, you know, your brassicas, your Brussels sprouts, things like in that nature, if you water every day, you're going to be able to mitigate it. But things like tomatoes, peppers, for example, onions, garlic, you water once every 3 days, you're actually going to have bigger bulb formation. You're going to have bigger root biomass that's actually going to penetrate the soil a lot deeper into the system. So that's something to think about. So shade cloth works, the watering method works, and then mulch. And this doesn't have to be fancy. I know some people say you have to use straw, you have to use wood chips. Sometimes it actually just involves simply just a piece of newspaper and then another piece of newspaper. So we're just going to double up and then we're going to put grass clippings on top. We're going to put wood chips on top. We want to use whatever's free to us. Reduce, reuse, recycle. We always forget about reusing. So reuse your biomass that you have in your yard. And in some cases, grass clippings are the ultimate Cadillac to this because it is so fine and we're able to layer it so thick over the entire year. So mulch, water, and then I guess the other thing is too, is we don't want to fertilize because our plants are so stressed out. We have wilting and so therefore we don't have as much rapid growth and reproduction happening. Therefore our nutrient needs have drastically backed off. And so when we fertilize in high heats, what ends up happening here is we end up with a both in the root system and the upper biomass, and it can exacerbate the problem and turn leaves yellow and cause all different sorts of issues. So we want to try to walk back from that when possible. The last thing when it comes to this is trimming. So we can trim our weeds. We want to keep our weeds back because we don't want that competition. But when possible, we want to harvest whatever fruits and vegetables are ready to eliminate the stress off the plant. In some cases, we may end up losing flowers, small fruits, things of that nature, but that's okay. We just want to remove them off the plant. But the leaves themselves, we want to avoid removing those as much as possible because they're doing two things. They're shading the biomass of the plant itself. They're shading surrounding plants, so they're acting as a shade barrier for plants around it, but they're also shading that soil from the intensity of the sun. So that's something to think about. Now, if we have cloud cover and we just have high heat, say we have 35 degrees Celsius, like we do right now in Saskatchewan, this is a different scenario. We don't have the sun, so we can pull off the shade cloth. We just have the heat, and therefore we can simply keep up with our watering, and then our mulch isn't maybe necessarily as important because we don't have the intensity of the sun, but it's there, so it's going to help with the actual water retention. So going at it, but I think the main thing is stay away from the fertilizer and keep up on the watering, but make sure instead of frequency, it's actual volume of water. So you want to water once every 3 days, but you really want it to drain through the system.
Okay, so it's really more about deep watering and thorough watering as opposed to watering every single day. It's watering once every couple of days, but giving a good deep watering that will help a lot of our onions, our peppers, our, I know for sure our tomatoes, that goes a long way. So that's kind of like the biggest takeaway, I would say.
Yeah, and I think that's for raised beds and in-ground. Mostly. Now, if we're talking about container gardens or people who have containers on the deck, those type of plants, you're going to have to water every day, sometimes twice a day. And it's because we have a closed system or we're working within a closed system. So we don't have the benefit of the battery that Earth provides. So
sure. Yeah, absolutely. Good point. We have a question from Michael Norris is asking, would adding vermiculite in the spring help with moisture retention during the heat waves that we're experiencing?
Yeah, so vermiculite is one of those products that actually provide aeration, but the main purpose is actually for water retention. And I'm sure you're familiar with that in the houseplant world and that sort of thing as well. The only thing is it's hugely dependent you're dealing with. So if you're dealing with a raised bed system and say you have, you know, peat moss or a sandy loam garden soil, then vermiculite is going to be a benefit and it's going to be cost effective. Now, if we're talking about a sandy soil or a clay soil, now the narrative starts to change, especially when we're talking about maybe an entire field or a large size garden that's actually placed in the earth. And therefore, vermiculite in that case may not be cost effective, or it may not be effective at all, especially within a sandy soil. So if we're doing container gardening, peat moss based gardening, or if we're dealing with small raised beds or raised beds that have a sandy loam, then yes, that would be of benefit because it does have those water retention properties. I use vermiculite actually for coating my seed trays in the spring when I'm starting to germinate my seeds. I will do a layer of peat moss. I will sprinkle my seeds down vermiculite because it does retain so much moisture while still providing some airflow. So
okay, fabulous. So that definitely sounds, I used vermiculite mostly for cuttings. I love using vermiculite for just, you know, for taking cuttings and having them root in purely vermiculite. I've tried peat moss solely, like a peat moss solution or substrate rather. I've tried just even peat moss as, not peat moss rather, but sphagnum moss as yes, a substrate for taking cuttings. So that's really interesting for water retention and it depending on, you know, the type of actual space where you're growing specifically. Yeah. So that's fabulous.
Yeah, and your budget too is going to be, you know, dependent on what method or what mindset you're going for sure.
And I think in general, if you have a raised garden bed, for example, that, you know, it's going to be a little bit, your watering method has got to be a little bit different than if you're direct into the ground. So these are some things that you certainly have to take into consideration when it comes to watering and being efficient with how much you're watering. Now, we wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, irrigation and adding irrigation potentially to your back gardens. I personally, and I'm sure you would agree, think that it's one of the best ways to effectively water your gardens with the least amount of waste as possible, because, you know, you're directing that water flow right to the base of the plants, right to the roots. You're not wasting any water on the actual foliage of the leaves that, as you know, can lead to bigger problems. But can you speak to irrigation systems and how those can benefit growers?
Yeah, for sure. So there's lots of different methods. And so in the city, we have a farm also where I have a garden and everything's hand watered with 5-gallon pails. So I get, you know, a little bit extra muscle put on in the summer months, especially this year here in Saskatchewan. So in the city, I do have irrigation and there's lots of different methods you can go with for this. So you can obviously hand water with the hose. You can have actual plugs going into the pots. You can have spray versions, and then you can have actual drip irrigation. And when we're talking about heat of this level, if we're talking about soil that's really poor at retaining water, then drip irrigation actually is the best method because it's going to be very plant placed and it's going to be in some cases a constant supply of water to some level. So that's very, very huge. Now, if you have a heavy clay soil, I would stay away from any sort of aerosol or spray version of watering whenever possible for irrigation. And the reason for that is because when we hit a clay soil, almost like a piece of cement. It's just going to roll off. It's going to erode. It's not going to capture the water properly, especially if we don't have mulch in place. So if we have a clay soil, you want to actually run your irrigation underneath where the mulch would be placed on top. So you're going to have the irrigation and then your mulch is going to be placed on top of that. With a sandy soil, we're able to maybe spray on the leaves, whatever. It's not as big. Our water moisture retention qualities it changes quite a bit when we have a sandy soil system. So in that case, we can have it a bit above. But again, if you can, right underneath that mulch layer so that the irrigation is actually in contact with that soil. And there's lots of different benefits to that and reasons why you would go that direction. Now, the thing to remember when we do irrigation, we're skipping a lot of steps in our plant care systems or just in our garden systems in general. So things you want to take into consideration is giving yourself a day on the calendar where you do fertilize or you do apply certain products to your soil. So if you have a really sandy soil, a really great product, especially in this high heat, is something like organic humic acid or compost tea, things of that nature that have a very high carbon content. And so when we use that on, say, a Saturday, and the reason I'm saying Saturday is because that's my day where I fertilize and I take care of my soil. So we irrigate throughout the entire week. And then on the Saturday, I hand manipulate my entire garden or my soil surface. So that's something to keep in mind. Just because you have irrigation, you don't want to forget about putting in your inputs, because we are taking so much out of the soil as gardeners, and whether it be from the vegetable standpoint or the flower standpoint, we're taking so much away. So we do want to make sure we take the time to put inputs back in. So that's something to think about as well. So, just your soil or anything in that nature is that you want to look at your soil structure. And so there's lots of really basic tests you can do in the garden at home that's going to help you determine what your soil is like. So this could be something such as a texture test, where we do a ribbon test. So we're actually going to roll our soil together and see how big of a caterpillar we can make. And if you can get your caterpillar over, 6 inches, that's a clay soil. If you're under 3 inches, then that's maybe a sandy loam. If you're less than that, that is a sand. And so therefore, when we look at soil in, that perspective, that's going to change how we treat it and how often we water it. So if we have a sandy soil system, then we are going to want to water on a more regular basis. And we are going to want to water maybe instead of every 3 days, every 2 days. If we have a clay soil, then we actually want to go in and we want to water every 3 to 4 days. So that's also something to think about, is the frequency in which you water. But if you don't know what your soil texture is at home, then it's something to definitely test out. Now, if you're a container gardener and you're gardening in peat moss, you guys probably are already very familiar with the water retention properties of a peat moss based soil. So for that sort of case, depending on how big of a system you're working with, that's going to change how your irrigation works or functions within the system. So that's another thing to think of as well. If you're doing container gardening, obviously you're going to be watering every day. You have a closed system. So that's something to look at as well. Another thing that people don't always remember, or they don't always think about container gardening itself, and taking the pot into consideration. And this can go for both houseplant people and for garden people. So when we have our pot, we have things like plastic and clay, we have terracotta, we have glazed terracotta, you name it, the list goes on and on. So if we have a terracotta pot, we're going to water more frequently than if we have a plastic or a glazed ceramic pot. So that's going to change how we navigate our potting systems as well. And for some cases, depending on what zone you're in and how hot your summers get, you may want to actually change that. So if you have a bunch of terracotta pots and you're noticing, I can't keep up with watering despite the fact that I do have irrigation in the system, then you actually may want to pivot and change all your pots to glazed ceramic or plastic. And if you have terracotta and you're noticing, it's working great for me, but I would like a little bit extra water retention, I want to cut back on my water bill, which is what most of us do want to do, we may actually just run down to Home Depot and there is the outside of your terracotta that's actually going to help with your water retention and keep it all knit and kept in. So that's also something else to think about.
Amazing. Amazing. I was going to ask, how can people at home do a soil test themselves? What is the best way that you recommend for people at home if they're not quite sure, if they're more of a sandy soil or they've got a really much more of a clay base? How do you recommend people at home test their soil?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. And there's lots of different methods out there. And typically, no one method is the best. So if someone who studies soil or is working in the field, they're not going to go with just one simple test. They're going to do multiple different versions of it. But there are some you can do without having to actually take a sample, send it to a lab, all that jazz. So a ribbon test is a good one. So making the noodle, seeing how long the noodle can get is a really good indicator. If you can get, you know, that long, you probably have a heavy clay soil. If it's falling apart and starting to crumble, you probably have a loam. If you can't get a noodle at all, you're probably in a very sandy soil. Another thing to look at is actually your soil system as a whole and your soil profile as a whole. And one of the best ways to do this is actually through something called a percolation test. So we're going to dig a hole and we're going to fill that hole with water and we're going to see how quickly it drains. If you have a sandy soil, you're going to see your water level decrease very, very quickly. If you have clay morning and there's still going to be water in that pile, and that's actually going to change again how you water and how you amend or treat that soil in and of itself. And Canada's an absolute gem at really confusing everybody because we are a part of an old glacial landscape, so we have glacial till, we have glacial lacustrine. It's an absolute minefield out there as to what you're going to have in your backyard. So what you have may not be what the same thing another influencer or another YouTuber has or Instagrammer that's literally five blocks away from you. It's going to be completely different from yard to yard. And even within a yard, it can be different. So you do want to test, you know, each individual aspect of your environment.
Sure. And that's another reason why it's so important to, you know, if you're creating a raised flower bed or a raised garden bed, to make sure, one of the best things about having a raised bed is you can control what you're putting in there. You can control the soil medium. And it's so important to make sure that you are getting the right soil. You are not just heading to a construction site and, you know, scooping up some soil off the side of the road because it's so hard to tell. There could be noxious weeds, seeds that are in that soil. There could be chemicals. There could be a multitude of things that you don't want to be bringing into your backyard. So, try to avoid that at home if you're thinking, oh, I really want to grow more. I want to have a raised garden bed. Raised garden beds are great. Maybe you want to fill up a whole bunch of pots that you have. Make sure that you are getting your soil from a reliable source, right?
Yeah, I've had that happen, actually. We have a community compost in my city, and so I just thought, oh yeah, I'll support this. I'll go grab some. But if the compost isn't composted properly, you can end up with not weeds. Areas that you dug, for example, if you're doing landscaping in your yard and you're digging up a certain area, you're probably thinking, well, I didn't have any weeds there to begin with, so I'll just throw this in a new raised bed. It'll be all hunky-dory great. But there's actually like a seed vault naturally built into our soil where our seeds can hibernate and last for many, many moons. And so we dig them up, we expose them to the sun, the air, the moisture, and then also we have a germination of horrible things. It's a lot of work for us. So yeah, you definitely want to get good quality soil when you can.
Big time. Absolutely. Because you're just saving yourself in the long run from having a huge headache down the road, realistically. So we have a question that's from Jeanette, and she's asking, how can I fix my soil so I can reuse it that has rot in it without baking it? So I think what she's saying is she's maybe had some root rot in her soil. She's wondering how she can fix her soil without baking it.
Okay, yeah, for sure. So I don't know if she is someone who's watched on my channel before, but I always am super anti-sterile soil and I'm super anti-baking soil. So anyone who's in the plant community or the container gardening community knows that this is a very common narrative, is that we want to sterilize our soil. And so there are some issues with that. And with that comes things such as pest increases because we don't have natural microbiota in our soil, but then also nutrient transfer. So when we have organic inputs into our soil, organic fertilizer. We don't have things like nitrifying bacteria, dephosphate solubilizing bacteria. I mean, the list goes on and on. And so if we don't have those bugs in our soil, we aren't actually able to transfer those nutrients that are in an inorganic form into a bioavailable form for our plants themselves. So our soil does not, we do not want it sterile. So she's on the right point from there. Now, what her concern is root rot. And so she obviously has an understanding that root rot is caused by bacteria. And specifically, you probably know this as well, Emma, is that it's anaerobic bacteria specifically. So it is bacteria that is growing in the absence of oxygen. This is a good thing. This means we can fix this. So we just have to expose our soil to a ton of oxygen. And so that involves fluffing it up, maybe adding a pumice, a perlite, you know, things of that nature that are really going to increase our air circulation. Volcanic rock is another great option. Mm-hmm. LECA, even you can work into the system, and that's going to add aeration, which is going to help bring up the healthy microbes. Now, if you wanted to get one step further and get this just, you know, really nip and tuck, is you would actually add an organic source of your original source. So you have it, you know, you have root rot in it. You're going to want to add things like a compost or a manure. Now this can be, you know, mushroom compost, animal manure, worm castings.
Yeah.
The list goes on and on. And so in that, there's going to be microbes that are going to eat away at the dead bodies of your anaerobic bacteria, maybe even some cases your live bodies of anaerobic bacteria. And then you're going to have a purified soil that's going to have the proper microbiota, not only to fight pests, but also to fight, you know, soil issues and nutrient transfer. And I think, Emma, on Instagram a while ago, you were talking about fighting thrips and that sort of thing. I mean, you guys, seriously, biological maintenance of both your soil and your plants is the way to go. I mean, I don't care if you use inorganic chemicals for your soil. I don't care if you use organic chemicals, neem oil, whatever the case is. But I honestly think everything starts in the soil. I may be biased. What can I say? But nematodes, if you absolute pro, throw some nematodes. You can get all-purpose nematodes that have a different variety of species in it. Throw that into your soil, whether it be indoor or outdoor, and trust me, your issues will be gone, because those little buggers will eat literally anything harmful in your soil. It'll be gone. It will not exist anymore because they need it for food. So
it really, it's, you're so right in that it does start with the soil, because a lot of people, I think, make the mistake of trying to combat pests, thrips,
fungus gnats,
all of the things, fungus gnats, by attacking or going after the adult form, when it's like, yes, it's actually too late, because those adults have laid eggs in the soil. So yes, that cycle is repeating and repeating and repeating. So going after the source with beneficial predatorial nematodes. And we actually have a question in here, so this kind of is a great segue. Somebody who is asking about adding, or how to deal with cabbage worms in their soil. They're from Moncton, New Brunswick. This is David. Hi, David. Cucumber beetles from returning year after year since they overwinter in the soil. And I think nematodes would be a great option. Another thing that I came across and I think is a great idea as well, and maybe you can speak to this, is if you have cutworms, or if you're dealing with a lot of these species of insect that go after a particular species of vegetables, for example, is waiting to plant them, is waiting a little bit to actually get them in the ground. Because when those grubs hatch, or when the larvae hatch and they don't have a food source, a lot of the times that can be a really great option for kind of weeding out some of the, at least early hatchers, and in kind of removing their food source. But is there anything further that you might recommend for people who are dealing with grubs, for people who have these cucumber beetles, for example, that overwinter in the soil?
Yeah, so I think slugs are one, snails are one, especially for you guys out in Ontario. You know, people in Saskatchewan don't experience this as often, but it actually does start in the soil. So you can get nematodes for this, ants in some cases. Like I know people think ants are beneficial, but anyone who has an ant infestation is gonna be like, no, they're not beneficial. They're eating all the roots of my grass, they're eating the roots of my plants. So again, nematodes are going to literally eat, like you said, those beginning stages of the bug. So, and they're not harmful to the soil whatsoever. They're actually incredibly beneficial. So, adding those nematodes will help. Other things that you can try is, like you said, either planting later in the season in hopes of starving them off or trying to beat them out. So, planting earlier in the season, start to beat when they would normally hatch, and then your food that you obviously want to eat. So those are two definite methods. And then oddly enough, it goes right back into the soil again. So adding things like diatomaceous earth, which can actually cut the outer edges of the bug and cause harm, infection, as mean as that sounds, but is definitely a method to use. I put diatomaceous earth actually a couple of days ago on an ant hill that I'm having absolute issue with. And again, I don't have any ants. It's 3 days later. So things of that nature. And then actually copper, oddly enough, copper rings, copper pipe put into the soil doesn't harm the plants, but it affects the microbiota of the soil and will actually eliminate snails, slugs, all that things. And you can actually get really pretty looking copper rings. I'm sure Lee Valley actually sells those. You can get like these copper spheres and like copper circular or square. Anyways, they're gorgeous, but they will keep out those pests, especially the ones that are eating on our foliage, because for whatever reason, they just do not like
That's so interesting. I've never heard of the copper. I've seen so many people, you know, talk about the eggshells, for example, to keep slugs out. Oh, eggshells, they're too sharp for the slugs to kind of crawl over, when in fact, slugs have a really high tolerance to, and snails have a really high tolerance to sort of that sharp material. But diatomaceous earth, I'm glad you brought that up, because diatomaceous earth is non-toxic, it's organic, and it's a great thing to add to your indoor and outdoor plants as well. And it's maybe I don't believe that you're supposed to use it in conjunction with nematodes. Is that right? Because it can have the same effect on nematodes as it would on insects. So I don't believe you're meant to use them together. Is that, am I correct in saying that?
Yeah, so like the issue is that nematodes, or all our microbiota for that matter, kind of resides in that top portion of our soil. And so a common misconception is that the microbiota, earthworms and stuff, you know, they go the whole spectrum of the soil all the way down to the bedrock, which isn't the case, because they do need the air, the light, and all that sort of stuff. So when we dust with a diatomaceous earth on the surface of the soil, gravity is going to do its work and move its way in. Water will move that diatomaceous into the actual soil system. So we're going to affect that first, you know, 2 feet or so, which is where a lot of our microbes reside, especially those really beneficial aerobic bacteria. So we do want to limit diatomaceous earth. Another word of warning for diatomaceous earth is some people will actually put it on the plant itself and on the cabbage in some cases, which is fine for preventing slugs and things like that. But you really want to make sure that you actually don't put it on flowers, because what it does to other critters, it's going to do to our pollinators as well, including butterflies, bees, you know, things like that. So we want to avoid actually putting it on the plant foliage, especially if it's near any sort of pollinator favorited plant. So we do want to be a little bit conscious of where we're using that. But it goes the same thing if we were doing an inorganic pesticide. Again, you want to be conscious of where you're putting that stuff, because we have kids, we have animals, we have pollinators, insects we do like. So we do want to stay away from that as well.
Okay, that's good to know. I think for people who are listening, who are trying to think about the right solution for their issue, and thinking about, oh, a nematode, what even is that? Like, and hearing that nematodes are microscopic worms that might skid, give you like the skids, might give you a little bit of make you feel nervous, but truly,
oh yeah, yeah,
they're not like these worms that are crawling out of your plants and into your pet's food or into your bed at night, or you know, and especially if you're using them outside, you're not gonna see these nematodes. Like, they really are microscopic. They're tiny heroes, tiny warriors. So if you're having an issue with grubs or with cucumber beetles or anything of the sort, nematodes are fabulous and they're nothing to worry about. They don't have a smell. They're not going to, you know, escape and take over your house and steal your car in the morning. They're totally perfectly fine and safe for people to use. And you're typically easy to find them at your local nursery. We have a question here from Michael Norris. He is asking, what are your thoughts on humic and or fulvic acids? How do they benefit our soil?
Yeah, so this is a new kind of product or a new idea that's out on the market. So it's using the idea of humic acid, and humic acid and fulvic acid are two soil compounds within the soil that we have noted as being present. But as soil scientists, chemists, we can't put our finger on exactly what it is. It's a little bit of a science mystery still. So if we actually dive into the journals and we look at things, it can be created in the lab, but there's no confirmation that what is created in the lab actually matches what happens in nature. So this is a Mother Nature mystery. However, we try to replicate it as closely as we possibly can. And so the way of actually making humic acid is having an organic compound and then substance to it. So we typically in this case will do like a titration or a drip method, and then the product that runs off of that would be our new humic, and in some cases there will be some fulvic acid in there as well. Now there's different ways of doing this. One of the ways is using different forms of coal that is actually mined out of the ground. So we would use the coal that we use to heat. So in Saskatoon here we have a coal-fired power plant. Same coal. Lateralite is actually what the specific coal is used. We would apply an alkaline mixture to it, and we would end up with, you know, a product which is humic acid. But there are other versions for this. There's actually Canadian companies that do this, and they use heavily degraded peat. So in Canada, we are the number one supplier for peat moss in the entire world. We supply it, you know, everywhere. Literally everywhere. And so we have, as we get down deeper into the bog, we end up with really thick, sludge, aerobic, almost coal, not quite there, yet, organic material. And so we will extract that out, apply that out. So if you look at the back of a bottle, or if you call the company, look on their website, you can actually figure out how they make it. Now the coal version is going to act the same as black peat version. It's just ethically what you want to use. Do you want to use the lateralite version, or do you want to use that black peat version of it? So I use the black peat version. There's a Canadian company that does that. That's the company that I go with. And so we apply that to our soil and it amount of carbon. So I want you to compost on steroids. So we are like a smoothie or like a juice. We end up with a huge influx of beneficial amendments, amino acids, complex carbohydrates, you name it, without the fiber we would have typically with compost, and it's easily and quickly degraded because of alkalinity. So that's happening there. And so there's lots of applications for humic acid. Peat-based soils, we can use it in sandy soil.
There's lots of information it seems about humic acid and fulvic acid. Ashley's going to pop back right back on here, but for those of you who are still watching and still live with us, if you have any questions, please feel free to type them either in the Facebook chat section or on YouTube. We're going to start asking Ashley your questions, your specific questions. So if you have them, please feel free to leave them in the chat now, and we will get those over to you. As always, Lee Valley Tools is now doing the live stream version of our virtual workshop. So make sure that you are tuned in and checking out all of them that are upcoming. I think we have Ashley back now. Ashley, can you hear us okay there? We're going to start.
Did I lose you guys?
Yeah, we're back, baby. Don't worry. We got you. That's perfect. No, the same thing happened to me earlier. But no worries. What we're going to do, Ashley, is I have a few specific questions that people are asking about their specific gardens. And we'll leave some time for anyone else who's watching that may want to leave a comment. Please feel free. But we'll answer any questions that are left over in this comment section now and hopefully get those to you. So we have Janine who's asking. She says, as always, great info. I have been watering my in-ground tomatoes and peppers every day in this heat. So if I want to dial it back to every 3 days, approximately how much would I give each plant? Is 2 liters enough each? My soil is loamy.
Okay. Yeah. So we're not dealing with the sand, so that's good. So yes, you can dial it back to once every 3 days. There's no issue with that. 2 liters, quite honestly, you might be going over the top a little bit. You could even go back to like 1 liter per plant, which generally equates to about 30 minutes of water time, 30 to 45 minutes of the sprinkler running, to put that into perspective, and you're good. You're good. Because you're not going to have the clay runoff and you're not going to have the sand that's just going to wash it all out. So you can definitely pull back, save a little bit money on the water bill, maybe reserve some of that rainwater for later. But yeah, you can definitely pull back.
Okay, awesome. That's perfect. Well, I believe we've actually gotten to everybody's questions here. Janine says, thank you. There's lots of people here who are just saying how much they love your YouTube channel. And for those of you who are tuning in, make sure that you do check Ashley out on YouTube. Her handle will be linked below in both our YouTube and our Facebook live streams. But as always, you can tune into us here. Make sure that you are following Lee Valley Tools on Instagram, on Facebook, on YouTube, on all of the things, because we are always wanting to do something with you, even in a virtual setting where we have experts like Ashley come in. Last week, we had Akhil from The Box of Life, where we talked all about worm composting and vermicomposting, which was awesome. But we're always looking to do something new with you guys and learn something new as always. So please feel free to check us out there. I'm sure this will not be the last session that we have with Ashley. You just have so much information that the world needs to know, and people just need to get about dirt. Like, if you love gardening, you need to know about the soil, because as you said, that is the foundation for everything that we grow. So thank you so much for sharing your knowledge with us today, Ashley. And please make sure you check her out on Instagram, YouTube. I'm also at The Urban Botanist on all of those platforms as well. Leave us a comment. Let us know what you want to hear about next. Maybe there's a specific topic that you want to know more about. Lee Valley Tools is always looking to grow our reach and bring to you guys, our viewers, more information and more awesome people like Ashley. So let us know in the comments. We will see you in the next live stream. So thank you all so much for coming and have a great rest of your week.
Bye.
Thanks, Ashley.
Yeah.